files across a wilderness of sagebrush and granite, feared as the great American desert. The trail from St. Joseph followed valley, crossed the Rocky Mountains, circled the Great Salt Lake, and passed over the Sierras to Sacramento. The first ponies left the terminal stations on April 3rd, 1860. More than 190 stations, often located in general stores, 400 station men, 80 riders, and 420 horses were needed to maintain the Pony Express. Delivery of letters and news dispatches to California had required months of travel by sailing ship, later 30 days by mule train, and still later 20 days by overland stages. Now the Pony Express offered delivery in 10 days. All letters were enclosed in 10-cent stamped envelopes. The rates charged for carrying the letters by pony were $3 for each half ounce to Salt Lake City and $5 to California. No special pony stamps were used in the first months of the express. The envelopes were franked with a running horse seal when dispatched from St. Joseph or San Francisco. The fee charged was written on the face of the envelope by the postmaster. Letters received by train from eastern states were assembled with telegrams, news dispatches, and local letters by the express office. They were wrapped together in oil silk to keep them dry. A way bill was signed by the terminal postmasters and enclosed with each group of letters. It was to be signed whenever the mail pouch was opened along the trail. A leather saddlebag called a mochila was used to carry the mail. The mail and way bills were carried in the pockets of the mochila. The pockets were called cantinas. They were carefully locked to protect the mail. One cantina was opened by the postmasters along the trail. The others were opened at military forts and terminal stations. The Pony Express riders were called couriers. The couriers were young men selected for their nerve, frontier experience, and general fitness. They were armed, but depended on the speed of their ponies for protection. Their work was full of adventure and often danger. They rode day and night. Only one mochila was used on a trip. It was transferred from horse to horse and rider to rider on its long journey across the frontier. An average of 15 pounds of mail was carried in the four locked cantinas. Each courier rode an average of 75 miles, changing horses about every 10 or 12 miles to change his mochila from one saddle to another. Openings were cut in the mochila to fit over the horn and cantle of the saddle. It was held in place by the courier when he leaped into the seat. Only a few of the couriers were able to stand the terrific pounding and physical strain of the trail. Some rode only a few days, others a few weeks. At least half were riding in opposite directions every day. Pony Express stations were often located at ranches along the trail. Stations varied from tents and dugouts to adobe, brick, or wooden buildings. Couriers passed the mochila on to the next rider at home stations. Home station keepers, acting as postmasters, were provided with keys to unlock the cantina used for way mail. The station keeper first removed the way bill and signed the date, time, and his station across its face. Today, old way bills stand as mute evidence of unsurpassed endurance of man and his faithful servant, the horse. Unwrapping the oiled silk package, the station keeper checked through the letters. he removed any that were intended for his station. With letters returned and the cantina again locked, the mail was sped on its way by the new courier. Leaping into his saddle, the courier spurred his horse out of the station. Horses were urged to their fullest ability between relays. Mile after mile was clicked off across the plains by the sturdy ponies. Stops were made at Fort Kearney, Willow Spring, and Julesburg. Couriers pounded off long, hard miles, timing themselves by the slant of the sun's rays or the rhythm of the horse's hooves. They were sometimes required to continue the journey when riders failed to arrive or Indians had destroyed the stations. On several occasions, couriers rode more than 300 miles without rest. Pony Express riders seldom failed those who waited anxiously for their arrival. Their horses were selected for speed and endurance. Western-bred Mustang horses were preferred by many couriers on the plains and in the arid desert regions. Station after station was left behind: Fort Bridger, Salt Lake City, and Carson City. Only youth born to the saddle could have ridden half-wild Mustangs at top speed day after day. The High Sierra Nevadas of California stood as the greatest barrier to the Pony Express trail. Across its snow-blocked passes, mules were driven back and forth to keep the trail open during the winter months. Many of the stock tenders were... Then, the saddle was placed on the horse. The stirrup was hooked over the horn to keep it out of the way, while the cinch was pulled up tight and fastened to keep the saddle from slipping. The saddles were small and made of lightweight materials. The leather skirts were reduced to a minimum. Stirrups were used with or without leather protectors called tapaderas. It was a modified design of the typical Western saddle generally used. The saddled horse was led to the tie rail. At each station, two stock tenders were responsible for the care of the horses and having them bridled, saddled, and ready for the incoming rider. The courier's arrival was the signal for quick trail ahead, or ask about news from the States.